on Hot Copy today is none other than Senator Serge Osmeña. Good day to you, Senator Osmeña.
Good morning, Karen.
All right. I want everybody to understand this transaction. First, I want you to explain what is insider trading.
Insider trading is trading on information that the public does not know except
okay.
you. Halimbawa, alam mo na may malaking corporation mag-iinvest sa kumpanya mo.
Mm.
Pero traded yung kumpanya mo sa market like Felix.
Mm-mm.
So alam mo po puputok yung presyo ng shares, no? So you buy first for yourself.
Mm-mm.
You're the insider because you have knowledge to inside information.
Mali yun.
Ah, yes. That's against the law.
Kasi may nagsabi, may kausap ako, sinabi ito eh. Eh, dito sa Pilipinas, we don't take information that seriously. Nothing is a secret.
Yes, but still, for the integrity of the market, dapat naman, eh, siyempre may mga director dyan, may mga officers dyan, mm-hmm. they will always have inside information. If they don't trade on it,
mm-hmm.
that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
But if they trade on it, to the disadvantage of other shareholders mm-hmm. na hindi alam, ayun, ang against the law. Labag
okay.
sa batas po yun.
All right. Ngayon, let's talk about exactly why you are questioning Bobby Ongpin and you want to invite him to the next Senate hearing. And I heard even Manny Pangilinan. I've spoken to a lot of people who don't exactly understand the intricacies of the deal. In simple terms, I want us to discuss it this morning.
Which one are you talking about?
Let's
the
start,
Hess loan or the insider trade?
No, let's start
the
first. Let's start first with this. Is there anything wrong with Bobby Ongpin being given a 660 million peso loan, which he has repeatedly said it is not behest because I paid for it in full? BBP did not even lose money. There are creditors who have not paid.
Well, they are defining in behest trading as a loan that has not been paid. Hindi po ganyan yan. Behest trading is a loan that is being given at the behest of somebody. Di ba? At may definition na po yan. Memorandum Order Number 61 issued in 1992 by President Fidel Ramos outlined 8 elements, any two of which would constitute a behest loan.
Okay.
So it does not say whether you paid it back or not. Basta ganun ang pagbigay ng loan, behest na yon.
Now, of the 8 elements where 2 you have to be found guilty, which part does Bobby Ongpin's loan fall under that's questionable?
Well,
that makes it a behest loan.
Some of our lawyers say 7 out of 8.
7 out of 8, okay.
Yeah. I'm not a lawyer, but I think about 4 out of 8.
Okay, let's name some.
Number one. The company was way undercapitalized. Mm-hmm. It had a paid up of 625,000.
Okay.
625,000. Binigyan ho ng 660 million loan. That is beyond the scope of any finance mm-hmm. committee to grant in any bank.
Okay.
All right. Number two, it was under collateralized.
Mm-hmm.
Ang collateral po sa second loan ng 510 million pesos was only the Felix shares.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Felix shares were about 80% of the value of the loan, which is against central bank rules.
Yes.
It has to be at least 2 to 1.
Okay.
So kung hihiram po tayo ng 200, dapat 400 po ang collateral.
Okay.
Hindi ho na maghihiram ako ng 400, 500 lang ang collateral.
Uh-huh.
Eh, pag bumaba lang ng kaunti yung shares na yun, patay ka na, wala ka ng cover.
Uh-huh.
All right. And then there are others like, it was approved in one day.
Mm-hmm.
Well, nobody gets a loan approval in one day sapagkat tatlong committee yun eh.
Mm-hmm.
The credit committee, the executive committee, and the board of directors.
Mm-hmm.
But they maneuvered it, so in one day, the loan was applied for, the loan was approved with the credit committee, the loan was approved in the afternoon by the executive committee, and it was approved in the late afternoon by the board of directors. Ang galing na Manila. No.
So the question really is, why would Bobby Ongpin have so much influence and power over the Development Bank of the Philippines that everything moved so fast for him? That's where the DBP is answerable.
Yes, a behest nga tawag dito eh, because if there is behesti, there must be a behestor.
Okay.
Inahanap po natin yung behestor.
So you believe there is someone behind Bobby Ongpin?
Oh, yes.
Do you believe it's the first gentleman?
Yes.
Why is
but
that?
But that's my personal
opinion. Okay. Now, why would you believe that Mike Arroyo would have had something to do with that loan?
Well, this is not the only loan. There are 7 loans they took out with DBP,
okay.
Most of which, not all, but most of which would never have been obtained without some strong backing because of the circumstances in which the loan was given and because of the conditions that were set aside.
Okay.
Dito lang sa Felix Shares, they waived 10 requirements.
Okay.
10 requirements. Nasaan yung financial statement mo? Wala ho, waived.
Are you serious?
Yes.
Not oh my kidding. God. Oh.
Nasaan yung credit history mo? Di bale, waived na yon. Huwag mo nang kunyan.
Yeah.
Which is shocking,
yes.
Because the Banco Central has always issued guidelines for prudent lending practices.
Okay.
You don't do those things.
Uh-oh.
And so these are the elements that constitute a BHES loan.
Okay. Now, can Ray David go to jail for this?
Definitely.
He can, but yes. He had said he didn't know that Manny Pangilinan was buying Felix. He just issued the loan.
You know, it's kind of silly because everybody knew that Manny Pangilinan was buying Felix.
Okay.
They just didn't know what price he was willing to pay.
Okay.
So even in Hong Kong, he had a very big 1.3 billion Hong Kong dollars. It's about almost 8 billion peso capital call for First Pacific. Sometime earlier in the year, about maybe March 2009, and he put there, he said, the purpose of this loan is to expand our mining interest in the Philippines, and he only had one investment in one mine in the country, which is Felix.
Yeah.
So, everybody knew, I knew.
Everyone in business.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
And so for him to say, I didn't know, was a bit silly.
No,
because
this,
he is on the board of Felix.
Isn't that even a conflict of interest? No, really, that Ray David would issue that big a loan to DVRI, which then acquired Felix shares, and David is in the board of Felix.
Well, strictly speaking, no. But what Senator Enrile said in the last hearing was that may nagsabi sa kanya na nag-ayusan na daw si Bobby Ongpin at si Manny Pangilinan sa presyo.
Mm-mm.
Ayun, and then they decided on 21 pesos and Felix was trading at 12 pesos. That is insider trading.
Yeah, all right. Now let's get to that. Reports have it that they had allegedly met sometime in 2009, Bobby Ongpin and Manny Pangilinan, to discuss the selling of the shares, all right? So first, for a layman's perspective, why does Manny Pangilinan have to go through someone like Bobby Ongpin? Why couldn't he have just bought all those shares at a lower price?
We should ask Manny Pangilinan that
question. I mean, you know what I mean?
Maybe he was trying to do a favor for somebody.
Because as a businessman, it doesn't make sense when
right.
The shares were at 12.75 and Manny Pangilinan is going through a middle person saying, I'll get it at 21.
Yes.
When he has enough power to acquire so much shares at 15.
You know, Karen, we're now in amending the anti-money laundering law.
Okay.
And because in the first two laws, version of the laws, there were many ways to launder money that we had not included.
Okay.
Gambling casino, real estate brokerage, buying paintings. I mean, if I wanted to launder money, and you had a 1 million peso painting, I'd say, Karen, I'll buy your painting for 10 million.
Okay.
So I get to launder 9 million
yes.
already, you know?
So are you saying...
And this is also a way of money laundering.
Mm-mm. But you're not saying he was laundering money.
No, I'm
money.
Not
That's
saying,
not.
No.
Okay. But it doesn't make sense to you
it doesn't
as
make
well.
Sense.
Yes. Okay. Now, did Bobby Ongpin acquire the shares and get the loan after knowing that Manny Pangilinan would buy it at 21? This is where it gets tricky. Or did he have those shares? Was he fixing already the loan from 6 banks without knowing Manny Pangilinan was acquiring it?
He borrowed 150 million in April from DBP. That
okay.
was approved, and he had a drawdown, so I guess he bought 150 million pesos worth of shares.
Okay.
But the big block of shares, the 650 million pesos worth, was already in November. After 4 weeks, he flipped and sold it to Manny Pangilinan for 21 pesos.
Okay.
So when did he know? Well, Senator Enrile said that he knew before he bought the 650 million block.
Mm-mm. So. No, that's pretty crucial.
Yes.
I think that's one of the most crucial information. I'm curious if Ray David will ever admit that he knew that Manny Pangilinan would be buying it from Bobby Ongpin.
That would not be a crime in itself. What would be a crime is how much would he be buying it. Because if Manny Pangilino were going to buy it only at 12.75 or 13 pesos, I don't think Ray David would have a case on his hands. But since within a short period of time, it was transacted at 21 pesos, way above the 12 pesos, that puts a lot of doubts into the credibility of Ray David.
Yeah, for me, Ray David has a lot to answer for. If he knew it was going to be bought at 21, because he sold BBP's Philex shares at 12.75.
Yes.
So that's like losing for the Filipino people.
Well, there's an opportunity cost of about 412 million pesos there, just on that little transaction.
Yeah. Now, do you believe Ray David's ignorance when he said in the Senate?
No.
What's that? He said something. It bothered me, actually, if government officials said this. In hindsight, we regret.
Sabi ko, hindi ka ba napikon? Kung ako ikaw, so, sinuntok ko na si Manny Pangilinan o si Bobby Ongpin sapagkat, punyamas ka naman, para kang bumili ng jeepney ko o yung motorsiklo ko ng 10,000 pesos, hindi mo sinabi sa akin na ibebenta mo ng 20,000 next week.
Okay.
At inutangan mo lang yan sa akin. So, you know, it's like buying my motorcycle for 10,000 and you're my friend. And then I learned after 1 week you sold it for 20,000 but you hadn't even paid me the 10,000 yet.
Okay.
Hindi ka ba mapipikon yan?
All right. Now, to balance it off, I was reading Bobby Ongpin's defense. He wrote it to Lala Rimando of ABS-CBN, who had written a series questioning the loan early on. Okay, I want you to react on this, sir. It can't be too long because it's quite long. Number one, Bobby Ongpin has said to Lala Rimando, which you can answer because it's the same. He said, "I organized the loan over a 3-year period." Okay, and approximately it was 4 billion pesos, and I dealt with a total of 6 banks in addition to Ashmore. My total loans with DBP are only less than 20% of the total financing I acquired. This is a vital fact which nobody seems to want to understand, since they want to make it appear that DBP and I had a sweetheart deal. This is a good argument on Bobby Ongpin's part.
Yes, but unfortunately, we're not taking that into consideration. All we're saying is that in this particular loan, DBP lost an opportunity cost of about 412 million pesos.
Okay.
The loans were given under the most
questionable,
flagrant circumstances. Okay. Under the law, 7 out of the 8 elements that constitute a behest loan are present, although the courts require only 2 elements to be present to be considered a behest loan. Now, they're always arguing that pag binayaran, hindi behest loan.
Yes.
Teka muna, hindi ganyan ang batas eh. Because it says loan, not payback. So, if I lend you money and I were sitting as DBP, and Karen, I'll give you this loan, interest-free, collateral-free, lahat. Pero binayaran mo, hindi pala behest loan yun.
Oh.
Although somebody ordered me to give it to you under those terms.
Okay.
Now that endangers, if you utilize that kind of banking practice, lending practice, that endangers the bank. Why? Hindi pera ng banko yan. Pera ng mga depositors yan. Eh pag alam mo ginagawa yan ng banko, eh sasabihin ko, teka muna, tatanggalin ko muna, i-withdraw ko muna yung mga deposits ko dyan kung ganun kayo mag-lend sapagkat sinusugal ninyo yung deposits ko. Hard-earned money ko yan. That's why, in every country, the banking, the financial sector is held sacred. In the United States, one very big guy named Rajaratnam, who organized one of the biggest hedge funds in New York, just got found guilty.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
Sentenced to 10 years and fined $11 million.
Mm-mm.
And this guy was big.
Yeah, but they take it seriously there.
They take it very seriously.
I mean, I don't think the Philippines takes this seriously.
That's why enforcement is a problem. We have to tighten up on our laws.
Yeah.
Because our credibility as a nation is not going to rise in other people's eyes unless we make sure that, one, our judiciary is clean, and two, our financial system is clean.
Okay. Now, a lot of people have been asking, if Bobby Ongpin were that questionable, why would a respected, huge private equity firm like Ashmore trust him with so much money?
Ashmore is under question here.
Okay.
Ashmore accepts almost anybody. And we're going to ask them to come over and explain.
Yeah.
See, Ashmore...
But do, I mean, are they answerable to the Philippine government? I'm just curious.
No, in the sense that if they wanted to stay in London, we're not going to go over there and exercise our powers of arrest, except that their reputation is at stake. Now, these hedge funds are not heavily regulated.
Okay.
So it becomes a conduit for money laundering.
Okay. Okay.
And alam mo ngayon, napaka-stricto sa mga ibang jurisdictions. So when you deposit $1 billion,
okay,
they will ask, Karen Davila, where did you get the $1 billion? We can't accept your money.
Okay.
But there are funds that will accept it and launder it for you through the British Virgin Islands or the Guernsey Islands.
Okay. All right. Here's another argument quickly before we go to a break. Bobby Yongpin said, you make a big deal about the fact that DBP sold 50 million Philex shares to me a few weeks before the MVP transaction, implying that there must have been something wrong or irregular or dishonest. The transaction, Philex was doing 9 to 11 pesos per share. I did not know DBP's cost of shares sold to me, but 12.75 was the closing price. I found out from your article that DBP at that point was happy. So you're saying DBP was happy? What's the problem?
That's the people's money. And if the circumstances surrounding that, not only the loan, but the actual trade, are suspicious, it is our duty to look into it. Now, when Senator Ping Lacson filed that resolution, I thought it would go to the Blue Ribbon Committee.
Okay.
And unfortunately, I found out it also fell on the shoulders of the Banking Committee, which I chair. So I've had to take up the cudgels. But it was a unanimous resolution by the Senate.
Okay.
No one objected.
Okay. And here's another one. Bobby Yongpin said, it does not take a rocket scientist to know that the First Pacific Group and MVP always want to have full control. And so I felt, he's saying there was no insider trading, it was his gut instinct, that at some point, Manny will want to increase his stake and have full control, as opposed to just being on par with SSS, the other major stakeholder of Philex. I was convinced that sooner or later, MVP would offer to buy my stake. And obviously, he would at a premium, and since it would enable him to take control. So Bobby Yongpin is saying, look, I was just smart. I mean, give me a break.
Well, I don't think he's that much smarter than other people who trade the market, and I've met a lot of them. So he's just feathering his own nest there. What I'm saying is that tell him to answer the charge brought forth by Senate President Juan Ponce Enrile, that he and Manny Pangilinan already had a deal before he bought the DBP shares.
But would Manny Pangilinan admit to something like that? I mean, I'm a bit of a cynic, but I'm idealistic sometimes. It happens. I mean, are you expecting Manny Pangilinan to really come out and say, yes, we had an agreement? I mean, give me a break.
Maybe there was a witness. I do not know who told this to Senate President Enrile.
Okay, but is Manny Pangilinan at fault? He's a buyer.
That's questionable. Others think that Manny's not at fault here.
What do you think?
He has certain fiduciary responsibilities sitting as chair of Philex. He knows that, well, I'm just a buyer here, but this is... What Bobby Yongpin is doing is insider trading, not letting the market know that he knows that I will buy at 21. So he might be
accessory
to the fact,
yes. No, it's the knowledge. It's knowing that it's going to be sold at 21.
Correct.
Yeah. Yeah. And how did that change the price of Philex after? I'm curious because I sold Philex quite early and I frankly, I'm wondering now. You're right about not knowing. I was a regular shareholder. I didn't know.
Yeah. Napikun ka ba?
Now, yes. Yeah. Now, napikun na. Yeah.
Yeah, it went up. It was shooting up like a rocket in the last 3 weeks of November. It had a slight dip, then it rebounded. It reached 19.
Okay.
So that was the highest traded price on the market.
Okay.
And Manny paid 21, no?
Yeah.
Yeah. And then it started coming down over the next 6 months to 1 year. But now it might be at 23, but a month and a half ago it was at 28.
Wow. Yeah. All right. Okay, we'll take a quick break. And before we take a quick break, I'm just curious, just to give, play the devil's advocate. People have said there is an interest here. Senate President Juan Ponce Enrile allegedly wants gambling, which Bobby Yung Pin handles. Is that true?
Wants gambling?
Yeah.
What do you mean by want?
The business of gambling.
No, a lot of people are in the gambling business.
Because Phil Webb is, and that's Bobby Yung Pin. So no interest.
They have a contract with PAGCOR.
Okay.
I haven't really seen it. So I hate to talk about it.
But when it comes to you, I've also heard that, Karen, what do you expect? Senator Sergio Smeña is a friend of the Lopez's. Of course he's going to hit them. Next is
who?
Bobby and MVP, because next is Meralco in the hearing. So what's your take on that?
Meralco, no, the Lopez's don't work that way. And what's passed is passed between them. They sold out to MVP, so why would I hit MVP if I were
biased? If you had an interest, you mean? Okay.
But the Meralco transaction is really awful. It's worse than the Felix transaction.
Okay, all right. I'll ask you to explain that. When we return, our guest, Senator Sergio Smeña, will answer questions from you, our viewers. Hot Copy will be right back.